Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for joining our live stream here at the Inez County Planning Department. We're practicing our social distancing, so there's very few of us here. But we wanted to bring you to a live stream so we can get your input and your comments on our plan to rewrite and update our land development plan for Inez County. We are not holding our public workshops right now. That is being postponed. We have not canceled them. We will reschedule those as soon as we are able. We do want to continue our plan and our progress on our plan and to meet our deadline for the end of the year. At this time, we're going to go ahead and present our presentation through live stream, and we will have Jake from Stewart do the presentation, and we will take comments as we go through live stream and then respond to comments throughout the presentation. As I said, this is Jake from Stewart, and he will be doing the presentation.
Hey, how's everybody doing? My name is Jake Petrowski with Stewart, a consultant firm that's helping the county out with updating their land development plan. Jackie Turner is also here, and she's going to be helping out on the presentation as well. On our team, we also have Greg Payne with Economic Leadership that's helping out with the plan. We're going to give a presentation, but periodically throughout the presentation, we're going to pause and ask questions of the audience. And you should be able to interact through the comments during the live stream and then also after the live stream. So we'll go ahead and get started. We're going to talk a little bit about the project and schedule and talk a little bit about issues and opportunities in the county and give the audience plenty of opportunity to interact during the stream. So the land development plan is the principal tool for community planning and county planning in Alamance County. The last land development plan was adopted in 2007. So a lot has changed since 2007 in the county. So it's time to update that. Some of the keys to a land development plan is it needs to be collaborative. It should be really document a conversation in the county from citizens and other stakeholders to talk about what's working, what needs to be changed, and how we can make progress on our goals. Comprehensive plans or land development plans typically have a 10 to 20 year time horizon, so they look out into the future and try to anticipate where the county is going to be and what's going to be needed in 5 or 10 years. It also examines the interconnectedness between different things, like how a development occurs, land use, economic development, recreation, historic preservation, and a lot of different other topics. Comprehensive plans are not regulations, but they could inform updates to regulations if those updates do help achieve goals set forth in the plan. And as Yogi Berra said, if you don't know where you're going, you might end up somewhere else. So really what we're looking at is trying to have a conversation throughout the county, talk about where we want to be in 10 years. What do we want to be true in 10 or 15 or 20 years? And then figure out a plan to make that a probable outcome. So what are we planning for? What's the area, the study area? Really, it is all the county, but we're focusing on not necessarily the municipalities or the town limits of Burlington and Alamance, but obviously we want folks in those areas to be part of the conversation, because if Burlington and Graham are successful, Mebane is successful, then the county is successful. But we're really focusing on the part of the county in yellow in this map. So 76% of the county that is county jurisdiction. So not in the municipalities and not in the extraterritorial jurisdiction or ETJs, but that county jurisdiction. But we want everyone to be involved, because you know a lot of folks that live in the county, you know, work in the cities or vice versa. So we want everyone to be involved. So this is the first question we're gonna ask the audience. So where do you live? Do you live in the southwestern part of the county, the southeast, inside of a municipality, or in the northwest or northeast? Just to give us a little idea on, you know, where we're hearing from folks as you comment further on in the live stream. So enter that in the comment section of the feed. And now Jackie Turner is going to come and talk a little bit about the project schedule.
Hi, I'm Jackie Turner, and I'm working with the Stewart team primarily on public engagement. And this is one of our public engagement events, a little bit different than what we expected. But I'll take you through the process for preparing the land development plan if you follow along with the project schedule. So we began in really in October with the first outreach, working with stakeholder interviews, October of 2019. And step five, or adoption of the plan, is what we hope to have, or which will occur in the fall of 2020. But right now we're smack dab in the middle of what would be our big public engagement phase of public workshops, a survey, which is you can take online now at your convenience until through the end of April, at least at this point, that's how long we have it open. You can reach us on social media, which this is one of the methods here, and we will have other pop-up events throughout the process. We had a community summit in January where we focused on economic development, but tonight it's a sort of a virtual workshop and presentation, which is not going to supplant the workshops that we had proposed that you saw advertised in the previous weeks. They will just be postponed to a date in the future. So going on to the next slide, a little bit about a land development plan, or sometimes referred to as a comprehensive plan in some communities. It can contain several elements, and those elements or chapters are tailored to your particular community. So you'll see some of the more common ones, land use and housing, parks and open space, agriculture and the environment, infrastructure and public services, economic development. And with what we have going on now, there are communities across the United States, I'd say in the last 10 years, that have been at times including a chapter on resiliency. And that resiliency could be from natural disasters, civic disruptions, or even something like we're experiencing now with a virus or pestilence and disease going throughout the United States. But that might be something that we look at. It's just sort of having a plan for the future, which always enhances how quickly you bounce back from whatever is impacting your community. So now, if you have any questions about the process, like what's going to happen when, how you can get involved, what things, if you have any questions about those elements that you saw, you can go ahead and write in the comments section of Facebook and let us know, and then we will answer those as we go through the presentation. And certainly we will, as Jake mentioned, those that we don't get to this evening will be answered in the future through one of our outreach methods, which is the county's Facebook page, and also there's a project website. So I mentioned that we had stakeholder interviews. We started the project in the fall, and we met with different groups, and you can see some of those identified here on this particular slide, but a wide range of people that could meet in a small group of four to five, six or seven people and talk about the particular issues. And those would be ones that we would consider addressing in the plan, but by no means is that exclusive of other issues that might arise or that you might bring forward. And so we do have plans to have additional interviews, which we will hold by phone call, but then also when we do have the public workshops out in the county, there would be an opportunity on those days to come and also talk with the planners that are there. So this is that Alamance Community Summit that we held in January. And the main presenters were Mac Williams from the Alamance Chamber and Ted Abernathy of Economic Leadership. Ted Abernathy and Greg Payne are with Economic Leadership that are also part of our team. And so we had attendees that there from business entities in the county, healthcare, governmental leaders, and we had a few citizens that had particular interests that were also invited to that meeting. And some of those themes are captured on our next slide. where we compiled like themes from the community summit and themes from the stakeholders. And then also we read a lot of the existing documents that the community has in place to see what folks have been talking about over the last 5-10 years. But one of the things that we do here often is preserving the community character. Alamance County has a belt of urbanization sort of running through the middle of it, parallel to the highway, but a very rural northern and southern parts. And there's interest in that character, in the rolling hills and the wooded areas and the lower densities, as well as agricultural preservation itself. And wanting the folks that are still practicing that to have everyone understand how they make their living and that there is value to the county, not just monetary value, but it's part of the county's history. And then one of the other assets, recreation, not that it's it provides you access to rivers and trails, but also it is an economic asset as well as just a quality of life issue for those that reside within the county. And so though this plan addresses the lands that are in the unincorporated parts of the county and the extraterritorial jurisdiction, it is also really important to make sure that we stay connected as we prepare this plan with what each of the municipalities is doing. So we have great partnerships with the towns and the municipalities, Elon, Burlington, Alamance, Graham, Mebane, and then we try to find out what's happening in their growth areas, where the growth pressures are, where their transportation issues are, what their infrastructure capacity is, and so that will definitely be coordinated in the plan. So Jake's going to now talk a little bit about some of the other development that's going on in the county. Thank you.
Thanks, Jackie. So some of those things that we heard about, community character and agriculture and recreation and partnerships, are things to build on, are things that we really want, we value, and we want to see continue or be supported in Alamance County. And there's also some concerns, some issues that are coming up that we're going to have to deal with more even over the next 3 to 5 to 10 years. Concerns over heavy industrial uses are one of those issues that we're going to have to deal with. Right now, Alamance County does not have county zoning throughout its jurisdiction. There are some ordinances that specify certain criteria for certain more high intensity uses to make sure that they adhere to if they're going to locate in county jurisdiction. But they don't necessarily have all the tools in the toolbox to prevent some of those uses to happen in certain places. The other thing that we want to do is keep industries in Alamance County, because we know from economic development and from a jobs perspective, it's necessary to have businesses and local employment. The other thing we're having to deal with is development pressure, especially in the southern portion of the county, due to soils and location proximal to some other job centers in Orange County, in Saxapaha, and in Snow Camp, and these places that have a great quality of life and are really close to other places. So we need to think about how much development do we want to have? What do we want it to look like? That sort of thing. So those are things that we're gonna be dealing with as part of this process. There was a strategic plan in 2018 that was adopted by the Board of Commissioners, and it kind of has the current vision and goals for the county, and it has a lot of recommendations that are relevant to the land development plan. It was kind of a high-level document that just pointed out some pillars, goals that should be kind of advanced through the county, but some of those are really relevant to the land development plan. So agriculture, smart growth, quality of life, public services, and here's a listing of those action pillars. So preserving agriculture was acknowledged as being very important in that strategic plan. Having a world-class education system. Encouraging smart growth and development throughout the county. Public health and safety, and making sure that the well-being of citizens is first and foremost. And then government accountability and resource management was also one of those. So you can see how these are almost goals that land use and economic development and how we grow in the county can really impact whether we're advancing and accomplishing these things or not. So here's another question for you all. What is a priority issue that you would like to see the county addressed in this plan and acknowledge and have some actions or some recommendations that we can move forward on? So enter your comments in the comment section of the Facebook Live feed, and we'll pause in a little while to see if you all comment on anything. And I'm going to pause probably for about 10 or 15 seconds to let folks catch up and see if they have any comments. So one of the questions we had was, how has the pandemic affected the outreach? So we did have three community meetings, last week, and then this week, that were planned and scheduled on the calendar, and we had to postpone them. So we're doing this Facebook Live event just to keep people abreast of what we're doing with the plan and try to get some feedback. But those three meetings and an additional one, so we do have four meetings that will take place whenever things are deemed safe for us to do so. So we're hoping at the end of April we'll be able to have some of those or sometime in May. But we're just going to have to kind of play it by ear and see how things go. Thanks for the question. So I'm going to go through and just talk about a couple of the kind of issues in a little bit more detail, and part of this process is doing some analysis of demographics and how land is currently used and digging into some of these kind of themes or questions that have been brought up from folks that we've already talked to. So population growth and land use trends is one of those topics. So Alamance County has been growing pretty significantly over the last two decades or so. It has experienced a 30% population growth since the year 2000. So that's pretty significant. So that's one out of every three people that you see in the county are new here, or one out of every three homes that is in the county has been built in the last two decades. So with that comes some challenges. Where has the growth been? About 30% of that growth has happened in the county jurisdiction, so outside of the towns and cities. So if you look at that and kind of put a number on it, it's about 5,000 new homes in the county jurisdiction in the last 17 years. If you extrapolate that out, then that's a lot of development pressure for new homes in the county jurisdiction that we need to take into account. And we need to try to influence where should they go and what should they look like, and how do we protect existing residents, how do we protect existing farm operations and that sort of thing from that growth. One thing we like to do is look at existing land use. So this is kind of a map of existing land use. You can see that a lot of the county is that darker green color, that's working agricultural lands. And then a lot of it is either vacant land or rural residential. That rural residential category is really one home on a larger property. And then we get into the single family homes and more higher density housing, and then commercial and industrial and parks and conservation lands there. You can see that most of the commercial and industrial is kind of along I-40 and 70, but there are a few areas outside of the county where you see those types of uses as well. From a tax base perspective, we also like to look at what is the tax base of Alamance County, and how could that potentially be improved in the future. So the current tax base is largely dependent on single family residential, about 44% of the tax base. Agricultural and rural residential and vacant lands account for 20%, and then commercial and industrial uses account for 17%, which is pretty significant considering they have such a small footprint in the overall county. So that's another thing that we're looking at is cost of services or return on investment by land use. So, and because when you look at Alamance County and where we're going to be in 10 or 15 years, we also have to think about where we're going to be financially in 10 or 15 years. And there was a cost of services study done for Alamance County, and it showed that for every dollar of services residential land consumes, it produces only 0.68 or 68 cents in revenue. That's very different than commercial. We're actually getting $4 in revenue for every dollar that commercial land consumes in terms of public safety, schools, that sort of thing. Agriculture is also a land use that actually has a lot of a good return on investment. For every dollar of services agricultural land consumes, they're actually adding $1.69 to the coffers of the county and tax base. So when we look at future growth and development, we need to take into account the fiscal impact of that growth and development too. And you know, speaking of growth and development, we also like to look at where that could go. We did an analysis of tax parcel data and looked at the land supply. So everything that is gray on this map is considered built and cannot accommodate any additional development, whereas agricultural lands available and underutilized lands in the green and yellows could accommodate different development in the future. So that's our canvas. That we have a lot of opportunity for growth in the county jurisdiction, and we need to determine kind of where we would like more growth or where it's not necessarily appropriate. So here's another question for you. What should the focus of land use policy be in Alamance County? Should we encourage more economic development? If so, where? Should we protect agriculture or natural resources? If so, what's most important to you? Should we encourage new subdivisions or better design? If so, where should we encourage them or what should they look like? Tell us if you don't want any new regulations or policies and we're doing just fine the way we are. That's also an option for us to kind of recommend. So enter your comments in the comment section it'll be interesting to see. Another thing I'd like to talk about is agriculture. So one bit of research that is pretty concerning is that Alamance County has lost 17,000 acres of farmland between 2002 and 2017, and that's based on the Census of Agriculture. If you look at acres and farmland, there's a steady decline since at least 2002. There's a lot of reasons for this. Aging farmers, high costs of land, market trends, but it is alarming because agriculture does provide for the economy, but it also is part of the culture and part of the character of Alamance County. So that's something that we want to look into and we want to be thinking about as part of this process as well. 17,000 acres. To give you perspective, how big is that? That's about the size of Burlington city limits. So it's a pretty big chunk of land if you put it all together. And if you continue this trend out, it doesn't look good in agriculture. And the county has done some things to protect agricultural land, but are we doing enough? And should we do more? And all over the county or in certain areas. And that's something that we need to ask and talk about. We're looking at agricultural suitability as part of our analysis and looking at lands that are most important for agriculture from a viability perspective long term. So looking at, you know, where are the working farms, where are conservation easements and voluntary agricultural districts, those protections that are in place now, size of properties and where the prime soils are, and concentrations of agricultural operations, and that might be where we try to protect things a little bit more. Another thing we're looking at is the type of residential development that's currently occurring in the county. This is just a aerial photograph of a new subdivision that's happening southwest of Eli Whitney. And this particular subdivision has 14,000 square foot lots and community well and septic, and it could potentially provide a conflict or cause a conflict with agriculture if we see this type of subdivision wanting to go in a lot of different places in the county because it causes more traffic on the roads. It's harder for farmers to move their tractors around on congested roadways. It also it increases the land value can make it hard for them to lease available land. So that's one of the things that we're looking at. All right, so I'm gonna pause a little bit here and see if we have any questions or comments that we want to bring up.
So no questions right now. In general, the comments that people are caring about, farmland preservation and environmental protections.
Okay.
And then right now with COVID-19, local businesses and local economy.
Okay. So the two of the things that were commented on were farmland protection and natural resource protection, and then also concern for local businesses, especially after what we've seen the past week or so. So that's important. Speaking of economy, we've done a fair amount of research from looking at economic trends and that sort of thing. And I'm going to present a couple of the slides here. It's worth noting, though, what we've experienced over the last week or so has been a shock to the system. Some of the recommendations that we might have had if this crisis hadn't happened might be a little different than what we end up with, just as we look to the future, what could be a very different future. So one of the things that we look at is household income. So we are tracking a little bit below the North Carolina average in Alamance County and below the average for the U.S. Educational attainment, this could explain some of those numbers of low income. We're a little bit under North Carolina average. We do have some good news, though. The unemployment rate in Alamance County, at least as of a few months ago, is actually lower than Guilford County and lower than North Carolina. So that's a positive. Another thing that is definitely a positive is job growth. So if you look at Burlington, this Burlington metro area is essentially all of Alamance County is included in this metro area. And a 6.5% job growth in the last 5 years is very good. It's not as much as some of the more urban areas like Raleigh or Durham, but you all are outpacing some of your peers, like Greensboro and a few other more urbanized areas. So that's something that we can definitely build on. A couple other recent successes, the Honda Power Equipment announced a $46 million expansion recently. Lotus Bakeries is a $17 million expansion. And the EPI Distribution Center that has a number of jobs and also $17 million investment. So we have had some recent successes, but it goes without saying, we're gonna have some new challenges after this month and the coronavirus situation gets resolved. So, one of the questions, one of the comments was, let's focus on businesses and support local businesses and what types of businesses should we encourage and where is a question that we would have is, what should we focus on from an economic development perspective in the county, supporting existing or recruiting new businesses, and also from a land use perspective too. So any of your comments in the sections, the comment section for this question, and we'll kind of keep moving forward. Another thing we're looking at is infrastructure and public services. So the Medlin Bypass is under construction, that should relieve some congestion in and around Medlin. It also is something that we're gonna be working with the Burlington Graham MPO on and thinking about where growth could go and what that impact that could have on road improvements and new roads needed. So especially plans for roads south of I-40 could impact land uses. So if we choose to widen some roads on the south side of I-40, then that could increase development pressure and we have to kind of think about roads and land use in tandem. And also we want to think about the impact on schools with new development. Where we put new homes could cause capacity issues in our schools. And Alamance County has spent a lot of money on new schools and school improvements very recently. So we want to make sure that we maximize that investment and don't cause us to have to spend more money where we don't want to. So opportunity to partner with cities and water and sewer is also important. Alamance County does not have a water and sewer system. All the water and sewer infrastructure is the towns maintain. So that's a limiting factor in some aspects, but it's also an opportunity for partnership if there's areas in the county jurisdiction that we think are appropriate for growth or for future annexation. So that's just some things we're thinking about from an infrastructure standpoint. One of the other things that was evident from our stakeholder interviews and also conversations at the community summit is that Alamance County does have a good system of county parks and community centers, and really it's exemplary for a county to have such a good system of these things. And you also have a very unique asset in the Haw River and the Haw River Trail. Even when we were having conversations with folks working on recruiting companies and economic development, they mentioned the Haw River Trail as an economic development asset and something that is beneficial when they're trying to recruit new companies and get people to move here. So that's important to know. And then also, in kind of juxtaposition of that, current county ordinances don't require any open space and new development. So when we talk about our rural areas and our sensitive natural resources, that could be something that we want to revisit if we want to protect some of those natural features while accommodating growth and development. I think we do have one more question here that's specific, and then we have another general question at the end, but what should be the priorities for parks in Alamance County? If you were to vote and tell us, would it be sports fields and more programs, supporting greenways and trails, like filling in pieces of the Haw River Trail or connecting to it, nature parks, and improving river access, or we don't need any more parks. So tell us kind of what you think should be the priorities for parks in the county. We had a couple questions and comments about what are best practices for development in different parts of the community. East of Burlington was mentioned, also around some lakes, and I think, you know, that's a question that we're kind of asking you all. You know, what do you see that is happening that you think is appropriate or you like, or what would you like to see something different in that area? So. Right now the county doesn't really regulate too much in terms of the design of development or the density of development. The density of residential development in particular is governed largely by availability of utilities and then also soils. So the health department does regulate, you know, how big lots need to be in order to have a functioning septic tank and a backup. But the county could play a larger role in, protecting certain natural features in development, or encouraging only, lower density development, or saying if you're, non-residential development or an intense use, you need to locate in a certain area. So that's something that we're going to be looking at during this process, and we want to get a lot more feedback about, where you want different kinds of development and what you want. And specifically on the survey, there's some questions you can drill down and we can get some more feedback about that. So definitely take the survey if you have questions about that. Yeah, and another thing that we're going to be working with municipalities, so Burlington, if it's in the extraterritorial jurisdiction, then Burlington has a comprehensive plan that really takes precedence in that that ETJ or where their city limits could be in the future. If it's outside of the city limits and the extraterritorial jurisdiction, then that would be county jurisdiction. And you know, I think the question is up whether those areas should have growth that looks more like what's in Burlington, or whether it should stay a little bit different. It should stay, more rural or a certain character, and you should know when you go into the county from the city, and that's going to be different in whichever area we're talking about. Okay, so Jackie, you want to talk a little bit about the next steps, and then we have one more question at that.
We're doing pretty well on time, so thanks for sticking with us. As I mentioned earlier, in terms of our outreach, we have a survey that went live a couple of weeks ago. We have a long link up here, but if you go to the alamancecountyplan.com, which is the project website, you can access the survey there. There'll be a link to it. And it should be open through the end of April. So it's not very long, it takes you less than 10 minutes, and it's a way to express yourself. Please take the opportunity to share it with your neighbors, the folks you go to church with, your colleagues at work, if you're going to work, but remotely, you're connected, please share it so that people can have a say in what is our most convenient way. Again, the three workshops that we had planned for the 17th, 18th, and 24th for this evening were spread out around the county. We wanted to cover the north and the south to make it convenient for you to participate. They would be roughly the same at each location. We will be rescheduling those, and so you will have an opportunity to come and talk with us face to face and bring folks with you. So that information with the new dates will be posted again on the project website or on the Facebook page. So just stay tuned to that. One other thing is, if you have, we also do pop-up events. And so if you have an event or festival coming up, now that we're almost we're actually officially in spring, and you would like to, there's an opportunity for us to have a table and maybe do the survey or maybe have an exercise at that event, do contact us or the county planning director, Tanya Cattle, and let us know what that event will be, and we may be able to accommodate it. And it's a way of our taking part of our workshop, a mini version, to you. So those would be the next steps, and I think our next question is a fairly just general, anything else you want us to know? And so Jake did take the time to answer some of the specific questions that came across the feed, but if there's anything else you want us to know that's not in response to one of his questions, feel free to jot that down. We have a few moments to look at those, and so I will step aside and we'll pause for a moment and see if we can answer some that that come up, but I'll turn it over to Jake to finish up here.
So we've had a few comments. So I appreciate the folks that have commented. We have some folks that on the parks question. Folks said greenways and trails, preserve as much natural areas as possible, and some concern over limiting the expansion of parks, that sort of thing. We had Donna who said be mindful of the rural areas, citizens who choose to live away from businesses and industries. That kind of gets into what we're talking about in the rural area right now. The county doesn't really govern the location so much as you got to meet this criteria on a piece of property. Either that criteria could be improved naturally, but then also we could have some guidance in terms of land use too. And then Donna asks, after the land development is approved, what's next? How will it affect its citizens? So the process for this is, we're going to be doing a lot of public engagement, in the April, May timeframe, hopefully if all goes well. After we hear from a lot of folks, we're going to have an understanding of what some of the issues are in general that should be addressed more than they are, and we'll come up with some recommendations. And they're going to be in draft form, and then we're going to come back to the public and have another meeting or two, an opportunity for folks to comment on what we're recommending. And that'll be another opportunity to interact with the process and tell us, well, you're on the right track here, or I really want you to do something different as it relates to this issue. And then the land development plan, ideally sometime in the late summer or fall, it would be kind of approved by by the county. State law requires that in certain cases the ordinances in the local development is in line with the comprehensive plan, and it should guide growth and development and how it looks and where it goes, but it also will guide county programs and how staff spends their time. It will hopefully guide infrastructure investment and investment in services throughout the county. So that's something that it'll happen. And then if there are some specific regulations that need to be put in place or updated, that would also be a separate process that would need to happen after the approval of the land development plan. And there's a lot of opportunity for input and customizing them as well.
That's what I asked.
Yeah, so it could inform updates to zoning ordinances. It could improve capital improvement planning, so the county partnering with towns or going on their own and spending money on infrastructure, and programs and that sort of thing. So ideally, this land development plan would be approved, and then it would impact in a positive way things down the line.
So there was a question about expanding our timeline for the plan.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think so the question was about expanding the timeline for the plan. The schedule that we showed earlier was created that it didn't anticipate a month of downtime, potentially more. So it really depends on when we get back to business as usual in the county, and when we can, have the public meetings, for instance. And, the timeline for the plan and the schedule, it's malleable, and we can revisit it if needed. If we need to extend it a month or two in order to make sure that we're getting the feedback that we need to get and going through the appropriate process. So I think at this point, if things turn around in a few weeks and we're able to get back to business as usual, I don't foresee a big delay, but if the pandemic and all the operations of the county is shut down for a while, then we'll have to revisit it. And that's just what we'll have to do with staff and talk to county leaders, and we'll revise the schedule accordingly. I really appreciate everybody taking their time to listen to this video, either tonight and also folks that will tune in later. The plan for this video is to actually post it on the Alamance County Planning Facebook page, but also on the Alamance County plan website, so that folks can view it after the fact. and hopefully interact with it as well in the comments section as well. We're still trying to make sure that we enable some of that functionality, and this is the first Facebook Live event that the county has done. So we appreciate your grace and patience with us while we kind of figure things out. But we thought it was important to have this event and give kind of update in what we're doing with the plan, what some of the issues are that we think are important based on feedback we've received so far, and then also give folks an opportunity to kind of comment.
We are having questions, a little bit of discussion about that Snow Camp Southwest area, area of the county. Give a little guidance on what we're looking at, where we're at with that.
Yeah, so as part of this land development plan, we're going to make recommendations that are going to be relevant throughout the county. And then the county did want to look at the southwestern part of the county and the Snow Camp area in a little more detail. So the way it's working is we're going to have some meetings throughout the county, but then we're going to have a meeting that's specific to Snow Camp area, and we're going to try to get some detailed feedback from residents and property owners in Snow Camp. And we might have some slightly more detailed recommendations for the Snow Camp or Southwest area. And it's called a Snow Camp Small Area Plan. So we'll have the land development plan that has recommendations that are relevant throughout the county. And then there'll be some recommendations that are specific to the Snow Camp area based on feedback we receive, you know, from that area. And it's one thing the county wants to do moving forward is actually update the land development plan in general, but periodically take a portion of the county and have some smaller meetings and some targeted kind of outreach in order to have some small area plans for different parts of the county. And we're part of this plan, part of this land development plan, we're gonna come up with some recommendations on how to do that. What areas are next, or how they can break up the county, and how we can kind of do some outreach and do some of those small area plans. But there's probably, four or five other areas in the county that also need some effort to really to find out what they want their part of their county to be in the future. So that's the short of it. So I will point you back to the survey. So you can either go to the SurveyMonkey link there and take the Alamance County survey, or you can go to the alamancecountyplan.com or the Alamance County Facebook page, our Alamance County Plan Facebook page, and get to that survey. It's a short survey. I think it's probably about 10 or 15, it's probably 15 questions. And there's some kind of multiple choice questions, but also an open-ended question or two that will really enable us to understand what your priority issues are and understand what you think needs to be addressed in this plan. Take it, share it with your friends, and that's really going to be a push for us over the next month or so. And that's another thing that the schedule we can adjust. I think the current thought is we're going to keep it open through April, but that's going to be dependent on are we getting a good number of folks taking it, and if not, then we'll make sure that we do some more advertising and get it out in the community and make sure that we hear from a lot of folks. And the other thing is that we will have paper copies available, and if you know some folks that would like 10 or 20 paper copies for their church or their small group or the Sunday breakfast club or something, let us know. We can get you paper copies, and then we can get them back to the planning department, and we can make sure that feedback is included in the plan.